My name is Toby, and I'm a Hackney born and raised.
My name is Bernard. Born and raised in Hackney, different parts of Hackney.
My name is Mustafa.
I'm another one raised on a different side of Hackney. And I'm here with Toby and Bernard. And we are doing the same thing, delivering a message, trying to see what it's like in LA and compare the youth and what it's like over there.
Here we are. Here's for the people.
I live and grew up in Hackney, and like obviously there's certain places I can go and I can't go. If I go places, trouble will happen and all of that.
Well, I grew up in the rough sides of Hackney, you know, like seeing a lot of negativity, a lot of violence. Grew up around a lot of it.
Nah, just across the road is kind of like where you're from and all that stuff. Like, I've been brought up in Hackney since birth, and I've known, kind of gone around different areas to know everyone, innit?
Hackney, there's so many conflicts between one another. It's like the conflict with their neighbours. One of them can't go here, the other person can't go there. Like, it's getting crazy.
You don't want to be socially excluded, you want to fit in where you're from. And if where you're from is hell, then you're going to turn into the devil to fit in. And I think that's what a lot of people don't seem to understand.
Basically, we're all from different parts of Hackney, yeah, coming together.
With a message, which is consequences in LA, and find out the differences between the youth gangs in America and in London.
One of the things we want to see in LA, whether it's the same out there, whether they have close conflicts, close civil wars within their community.
LA, home to Hollywood and Beverly Hills, entertainment capital of the world. LA, also the gang capital of the world. There are over 250 active gangs in the city of Los Angeles, with over 26,000 combined members. We'll be right back. In the last 5 years, over 23,000 verified violent gang crimes, with 784 murders, nearly 12,000 felony assaults, 100,000 robberies and 500 rapes. In the last few years, youth violence has been rapidly spreading from the inner cities to the suburbs. Gangs are now everyone's problem.
This is the crib in Los Angeles, Emeka, and the team. This is where we all reunite, first of all, get to know each other. The main man is sleeping, or he's tired.
11-hour flight. And about 6 hours to find this place.
Another 2.5 hours in the airport. Here's a quick view of LA, the outside. As you can see, I'm looking for Jeanette and Bobby. This is known as the bonding room. One day in the bonding room. Let's see if everybody can bond in a day. Day two, LA. As you can see, everybody's now bonded. Well, you can't see well, I'm telling you. Everybody's now bonded. The team is doing well. Everyone's out enjoying themselves. Day one was murder. Basically 12 hours on the plane. Come off another 3.5 to 4 hours in the airport because of complications.
Instead of coming here with a British passport, I tried to see the difference by coming with my Nigerian passport. Arrived here, it was a bit mad because you get through the doors and the next minute they're taking you to a room. They want to ask you questions about why you're here and that. But then again, I thought, alright, cool, fair enough, because I didn't bring my British passport with me.
The only thing I didn't really like was when I was in the airport, the way they disrespected me and one of my newfound friend members of the crew. Basically, for him having a Nigerian passport with an American visa in it, they thought there was something dodgy going on, so they took him away.
They might send him back. It was like 2 hours now, like 2 hours, and then he told me to come and then stamp my passport and all that. I said, well, if you're ever going to go to America, go with your British passport, because going with another passport is a bit hard. The next time I come, I'm definitely taking my British passport with me.
Serious luggage checks, so be careful what you bring. And they checked my baggage. But they checked mine in a certain way. They didn't check anybody else's like this.
Yeah.
He asked me every question on the visa application twice. Then he opened my luggages, cut open my shower gels, checked that there were shower gels, messed up my luggage, and tried to ask me to put it back.
Yeah.
And then to find our hotel, no sat nav in LA. Treacherous disaster. Driving around the whole of LA for a good 2.5 hours again, but it was enjoyable.
After settling in, we went around LA to get to know our surrounding areas.
Days you've been here, I've had help from almost everyone in here. Everyone's generous, especially people that live right next door to us.
The hostel made me interact and meet new people straight away, as well as a hotel. In the hotel, I won't see people as much as I do in a hostel. The hostel's like another youth centre.
Hi, Bobby. What's his name?
Bernard.
What's his name?
Big Daddy Moose.
Big Daddy Moose? And the main man himself? Mecca. Now.
You see, this is why I say don't rush me, because I forgot my cream. Slow and steady wins the race.
Where are you off to now?
No, don't wash it.
Just packing our clothes, man. Packing some of our stuff.
Do what?
We're going to be moving to a different house, yeah, bigger house.
Did you? What about? Did you like the hostel experience? What did you think about that?
It was so cool,
bro. It's cool, like,
it's unbelievable.
It's cool, dude. It's like welcome. It's cool down there, man. Like, everyone's like, it's proper welcome. It's like
they're friendly.
Yeah, it's like the first impression is cool.
Yeah.
Getting ready to leave the hostel and make our way round to the new house. Driving through the wealthy parts of LA, making us wonder what the differences would be when we visit Inglewood.
Right now, having some food. You me?
Hot tub's out there.
Hot tub, man, soon touch that.
What are you up doing? What are you cooking?
I'm washing up the rice.
He's washing up the rice, I'm cutting the cabbage.
You got cabbage duty.
What are you up gonna actually make?
Chicken, rice, and
I am salad,
not salad.
It's good bringing you along. You've got your food hygiene, haven't you, Bob?
Yeah.
We are now settling in and having our first meal at home.
No one pray.
Hi, it's Wednesday today. This morning started off with Toby coming in the room and turning on the light while we were sleeping. Obviously, I had a little moan about that.
Mm-hmm. Woken up by a maker's trap that was planted in the middle of the room. Blackberry went off, alarm was going off for a long time. Nobody wanted to get up and get it. Somebody finally did. Switched on all the lights to wake everybody up.
Yeah, we woke up around 6 o'clock. Struggled to wake everyone up. I was up though. I didn't know that to wake me up, you know.
I was waking up at that time. Yeah, man, in the morning it was funny, man. Roy snoring and Toby snoring. Moss was not that cold.
Hungry. It's not even 7 o'clock yet and we've got people in the kitchen. Bones. More bones.
On Wednesday morning, after all the fun and games, we got down to some serious business. We are planning our week, brainstorming what questions we would ask the people we meet.
I said, what inspired you to become a youth worker and why? What changed?
Yeah, what changes would you do to help them?
Both sentences do young people get for some of the crimes that's been committed by young people in London? So, what's the sentence for that? They got nicked once.
What are your feelings, your emotions? Does it make you angry?
Sometimes I get angry sometimes I get more emotional, you understand me? Most of the time I get more emotional too. Things in London was happening now with kids then, it's just stupidness, you understand me? They're killing each other for no reason, by science and all that, you know?
How does it make them feel to know what the youths are doing?
Yeah, holding a firearm.
Teenage ones got a firearm. What sort of sentence have they get in comparison to how we in London? Would you, if you got caught with a gun, would you be allowed out on bail? For instance, don't forget, like, you're looking at the judicial system, how it differs from what it does in England. Do we think we're too lenient on young people in England? That's the reason why they're still reoffending. to have. You know what I mean? What's their reoffending rate?
Because even in the UK, we're trying to get like tougher sentences and deterrence to try and stop young people to get into certain kind of crimes. But what I was saying is that in comparison to what happens here in America, is that the actual way to go? Because they have the ultimate sentence, which is the death penalty or higher sentences. Is that the route to tackle it? Because when people commit crime, they commit crime in hopes of not getting caught. So whether or not you've got a death sentence or the highest sort of sentence, is it tackling the actual issue? Because obviously they have all these big punishments here, but it's obviously this rate of crime is still very high.
What inspired you to become a youth worker and why? The specific example of where a change has really happened to somebody. Yeah.
Must have changed.
How has much changed?
Before, we used to be a person that he used to be kind of, how I can put it, quite rough.
Yeah.
And now he calmed down now. So now he's trying to do his own thing, like, chop his own business now. Because other kids have been a youth worker, that's key.
Yeah.
So keep yourself in your mind now. He's going to college now. And so on. So from being checked to help him out. Before, he was being really rough. Now he's calmed down and now he's doing things, man. He's trying to do things with his life now.
So basically,
Because don't forget, you've got loads of people over here that can afford to have their kids, like, look after their kids really good, and their kids can go to university and all things like that. Is it poverty that creates the higher reoffending in this country? Because you know what I mean?
What change would you make if you could start again?
On our way to Homeboy Industries. Homeboy Industries was created in 1988 by Father Gregory Boyle, also known as Father G. He started off by riding his bike through Boyle Heights and engaging young gang members.
Just a little bit about myself. My name is Joseph Hogan. I've been working at Homeboy Industries for almost 8 years, off and on, meaning I've had some trips and slips. I had to go back to prison, come out, and but that's what Homeboy Industries is about. It's not only about a first chance, but sometimes it's a second, third, fourth, fifth chance sometimes. I've known Father Greg Boyle. He's the founder of Homeboy Industries. I've known him since I was maybe 11 or 12 years old. I was one of those kids out on that street corner selling drugs, shot twice before the age of 16. I could see as far as my street sign, and I would have died for what it said on that street sign. That's the way I live my life. We talk about changing the world, right? But really it starts in your own community. Because we get asked the question, why don't you bring Homeboy Industries to Alabama or to somewhere else, right? And we don't want to be the McDonald's of gang intervention. We tailor to our community. So, if a person comes in here and asks for a certain service enough times, then we're going to create that service. Because that's what the community needs. And then you know what you need in your community, right? So we do it in our own community and we meet at the top, right? Father Greg has always had his hand in my life. He's always been a really big influence, and he steered me in the right direction. It took some time. We like to call Homeboy Industries a gang rehab. So we have people here on different levels of recovery. I'd be lying to you if I said, everybody here has changed and everything's wonderful, because we have people that are still in the process. Yeah. You don't wake up one morning and say, I'm gonna stop gangbanging, I'm gonna stop, living that life. It's not that easy. In the early days, we would go out on the street corner and, gather them up, and I'm not knocking that. But we feel that, the change, it's your choice. It works better that way. Because the old saying, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make them drink.
Yeah.
This is a place for people who want it. So this is the Homegrow Cafe. The Homegrow Cafe is made up of mainly women. A lot of the women are just released out of youth authorities, prison, jail. Some of them might not have skills. It might be a first job for a lot of them. So they gain different skills like sales, they learn how to work cash register, customer service, cooking, cleaning, that sort of thing. Okay, so everything that's here is made here at the cafe.
Well,
we met Fabian, an ex-gang member. now an artist, who shared his stories with us.
My vision is to shine light and put the homeboy in a whole different setting. A lot of times, just to break the stereotypes and assumptions that that are tend to be placed upon us. As an artist, I paint images of identity, culture, gender, and what that is too, because of, I see the beauty in all gang members. I try to find the divine in the image of a gang member. If no one gave me the opportunity, maybe I would be painting these beautiful paintings. You know what I'm saying? So no one gave up on me since I was growing up. I'm an ex-drug addict, and so I have been spiritually awakened by a near-death experience. And so now art gave me an identity, meaning that when I left the gang culture, all this time I was looking for love, respect, and recognition. And I was looking for it in all the wrong places. But all this time, I had it in me. The minute I put a canvas on a gallery, I get love, respect, and recognition.
The way we have to go through what we have to go through to get to where we access it is a...
Yeah, and sometimes I took a beating. Yeah. I took a beating, and sometimes and thank God, and we pray to God that we come back. A lot of the homies leave and don't come back. Yeah. That's the risk we take. But we cannot save the world. We can save a life at a time. Mm. And that's what we believe in, because when Father Greg Boyle found the gift of art and returned it to me, meaning that he saw me and my child, you know, what happens is he's changed my life. So now my kids have a better opportunity because there's no gangs, no drugs in my household. Mm. So if he can save one life at a time, it will impact the lives of others eventually. And so then again, gangs have no control.
So basically, we've all got our own individual gifts. It's about us going within ourselves and seeing what... Not like that, but seeing what our doorway is, what our escape is, like us individually. Like some, like Bernard likes to play the drums.
Right.
Like, do you know what I mean? Like we've all got our own individual type of...
So what it is like this. Yeah. What I try to do as a person, as a service provider, an ex-homie, whatever you want to consider me, what I try to do, we all have been blessed with a gift. Mm. That gift, it must be found, because that gift will give you self-worth. Mm. The minute we can allow you to get beyond the low self-esteem and the I'm no good and no one loves me, no one cares for me, the minute we get beyond that, then you will tap into your gift. And that gift will be something that can allow you to progress in life and give you meaning, identity, definition.
A lot of people think, you know, you have people that say, you know, I joined the gang because it was flossy, it was, you know, I like the, you know, the jewelry, the women and stuff like that. That's not true. It's because, you know, and G, you know, I quote G when I say, you never met a hopeful kid that joined a gang. Mm-hmm. G always talks about a city being sick, the whole city being sick, and nobody knowing what to do until somebody addresses the sewer system. So it wasn't about that, it was about something totally different. You know, it wasn't because I grew up and I just wanted to be a gangster. It was more like my mother was putting cigarettes out on my face, or I had to watch my father beat my mother, and I didn't want to go home. So this is what I found outside. So we're all running from something and looking for something at the same time.
What we find, to your definition of a young person getting into a gang, is a bit more different to some of the circumstances is in London. Because some of the young people that we actually work with, they've come from a lovely home, two parents, and that stuff. They've got that nice environment. So like, yeah, but what it is, so we find that sometimes it's about greed and about, what, like you said, about wanting to floss, wanting to fit in. So something else is missing, but sometimes what we're trying to do is trying to put our finger on that. And we always point our finger on young people that come from broken homes, that come from parents that are drug addicts and things like that. But you do often get kids that have got two parents.
Good homes. Yeah. Sometimes you hit it on the head, you know, because there's a multiple of reasons why people join gangs. You can have a great mother and father at home, but there's always something missing. There's something, there's one component in there that just wasn't paid attention to, or something, you know. And you say, we try and find what it is and put our finger on it. Mm. And that's what we do here.
Yeah.
You know, and at the same time, we can reverse it. And he talked about people having gifts. We all have different gifts. You know, mine is poetry. He writes poetry, he does art. You know, maybe, growing up, we didn't express ourselves in ways that we knew how to do it. You know, because back then nobody was saying, well, write this down or draw a picture or, you know, because in his story he talks about Father Greg saying, you know what, go draw me a picture. You know, draw me something. And he gave him that light, like, you know what, do it. After his teacher ripped it up at school. You know, so it's, we all have a gift, and maybe we weren't taught how to express ourselves or what it is, but now we're finding out what it is, and that's what we do here at Homeboy Industry. We find what you're good at, and we pull it out of you, and say, this is what you're about. This is what you're meant for. Not to stand on a street corner and get shot, or to hold a gun.
Homeboy Industries have a calf, bakery, and silk screening business.
We got cakes, flans, muffins, danishes, all that sort of thing comes out of this area right here, all the sweet stuff.
Kids that are going through troubles. It's private, it's confidential, it's between you and your therapist. Compared to the rest of the building, it's glass, everything see-through, nothing is a secret here except this. This is confidential between you and your therapist, and nobody else has to know. A lot of us have suffered a lot of experiences, traumatic experiences, been in prison for many years, had a lot of things that happened in our life, and this is where we're able to let go of these things and talk about it. We come from a background that we don't talk. Silence is a code, and we keep it.
Yeah.
But we're trying to break that cycle.
Yeah.
We do farmers markets, and this is where we ship out the bread, bring it in.
Mm-hmm.
But the real magic here is that these are rival gang members working side by side.
Yeah.
So these are, you know, so-called enemy gang members.
Yeah.
Back in the day, we would have shot at each other, tried to kill each other. But today it's like we're all just working together.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, in the beginning, because we get guys that come here and they might still be active in the gangbanging. And we tell them, hey, look, you're gonna be working with this dude, man. He's from that, a different set. You know what I mean? He's from a different hood. How are you gonna deal with that? And he might say something like, I just won't talk to him, or something like that. But 3-4 months down the later, they're having lunch together, you know, they're the best of friends, and it always happens that way because this place is built off of hope, love, and compassion.
It's really easy for other gang members to set in.
Not all the time. Every now and then we might have a little dispute, maybe a fight or something like that.
Yeah.
But you know, it's like, you know, do people shoot into churches? Yeah, they do. Do people shoot into school grounds where there's kids playing? They do. Is Homeboy Industries exempt from something like that happening?
No.
No, we're not. But it's rare when it does, because Father Greg Boyle, G, he's been very consistent with us. You know, we come from broken homes. We come from places where we're used to having our fathers walk out on us, or stepdaddies, or whatever. You know what I mean? And this man has been consistent. I've known him since I was 10 years old. I'm 32 years old now.
We got the opportunity to interview Little Lady Evil, an ex-Crip gang member, who told us about her violent past and how she's making the transition to change.
I came to Homeboy Industries basically. I knew G all my life. When I grew up in the projects where he came from or whatnot, and he knew my father, my mother, my grandma and stuff. And going in and out of juvenile halls and stuff, he used to always come visit me and stuff, and he used to always tell me, get out, you can come get a job, you can come get a job. But I always thought to myself, I'm never gonna come to Homeboys. Like, you gotta work with your enemy, and you gotta work with all these Hispanics, and that wasn't my get on. Like, I was real bad. And then recently, when I got out of jail in 2008, I was at the point where I didn't have no money, I didn't have nowhere to go or whatnot, and I was back on the streets. And Father Greg had called my grandma and was asking about me when he told me to come down to come see him. So I came down here to the new building, and when I came down here, I sat down here all day. I was here at 8 o'clock. I didn't get to see him till about 4:30. And when I finished talking to him, he gave me a job. The same day he was like, really? You hired or whatnot. And then the next day I started working, and ever since then, I've always been here since 08. And then just a day.
You said that you got shot. Mm-hmm. Why did you get shot?
I ended up getting shot in 2008 when I got out of jail in October. When I had this man, he was an older man. He was from a different hood, one of my enemy hoods. And when I was 14, I had robbed him with my homies, And I made him feel lesser than a man, I made him strip naked and stuff. And I never thought that it was gonna ever play a role in me when I got older, that he was gonna come back and try to do something to me. I ended up going to jail. I was in jail for 2 years, still never seen a man or nothing. So when I got out of jail in 08, he saw me, in my hood. And we had a confrontation and we was arguing back and forth, but I didn't remember him. And he kept saying, you don't remember me. And I'm like, nah, I don't remember you. Like, boy, get up out my face. And make a long story short, I'm trying to walk off. And as I'm walking off, I hear my homie saying, he got a gun. And all I'm hearing him saying is, I'm gonna kill you, bitch, I'm gonna kill you. And he just starts shooting. And as he's shooting, I'm running. I got hit in my hand, I got hit in my side, and it came on my back. This is my spinal cord, and this is my bullet hole. They tell me it skinned my liver, fractured my ribs. They thought I was gonna have internal bleeding. They tell me I was gonna be paralyzed I wasn't supposed to walk or nothing like that So it's a miracle that I'm here and I'm still walking and stuff and still doing me.
Has that totally changed your attitude?
To be honest with you, it took a lot for me to change my attitude to where I'm at right now. When I got shot, it just gave me a different outlook towards life. I'm grateful I'm not in a wheelchair. Like, I love moving, walking. I was a waitress in Homegirl Cafe, so that really put a setback on me. And thinking that I was going to be in somebody's wheelchair. And I used to see the homies that work up here that said wheelchairs, and I used to just pay attention. Like, that could have been me. Could have been in somebody's seat real fast And I took a different outlook on life. I tried to switch up but I was still sliding, but going back to my hood, still hanging with the same people But it took a big turn up on me to change my attitude towards a lot of stuff. When I look at life, it's totally different I got a conscience now. Before I used to didn't go out with a conscience, I just go.
Always been like a gangbanger.
Yep. My mother and my father, they both gangbang. My mother and my father, they both from the same hood where I'm from, East Coast. Growing up, that was my lifestyle. My uncles, god uncles, everybody in my family, they all gangbang. So that was what I knew. That was what I seen on a daily basis. Guns, violence, dope, all types. So that's what I grew up to be. And sad to say, but it's life. Out here, when you gangbang, when you're part of a hood, it's like a family because you're looking for something that you didn't have at home. When somebody gangbang going to a hood, it's like you're trying to find love and support that you couldn't find at home. You go towards a hood. When you go to a hood, it's just like recently, I just caught a case my big homie fronted me some dope. I ended up going to jail, I lost all the dope. When I got out, it wasn't so much how I had to pay him back or nothing. It's to the point where we're going to step up and see what we're going to get from now. We're going to get us some more work and we're going to get our money back together. Like, it's not so much you got to pay him back or I'm going to turn against you or I'm not with you no more. It's like, you're going to always stay together. Like, that's part of being in part of a gang.
It's a united group. Family.
Yeah, it's united family.
And you all look out for each other. So yeah. What's yours is theirs. What's theirs is yours.
Yeah. Exactly. Over here, homeboys is real hard. Like, homeboys is mostly like a respect thing right now. When you come to homeboys, it's like you got to leave all the bullshit up out of you. Like, you got to think more of a soul. As G, G is our father at the end of the day. Like, G gets so many people, so many help. So it's like, if you disrespect him, it's like you disrespecting yourself. And I don't know, you get too much help up here. But up here, it's a lot of race tension. Because up here, it's just like being in a penitentiary. Being in the penitentiary, it's the blacks and the Mexicans. It's always segregated. And being up here, it's just like it's segregated also. It's not that many African-Americans that work up here. It's majority of Hispanics. When you first started this, it was for Mexicans. And just blacks just start coming when you move to this new facility. So it'd be real hard. Like, it depends on how you gonna go for it. I done had a lot of problems with Hispanic girls when I first was working here. I fought a lot of Hispanic girls in the cafe and over race, and cause you call me a nigga or you call me a bitch and I'm going off my jail mentality. Like, girl, it's like me back in jail. Like, I'll fight you real fast. It's nothing. But Mexicans and blacks, it's still hard. But up here, we try to keep it as cool as possible. But that's a big tension.
family.
Yeah, homeboys is my family. The Hispanics, Chinese boys that be up here, anybody that come to homeboys and whatnot, if you trying to change, if we on the same path, if we trying to get to the same thing, I'm all for you. Like, I'm with you. And if somebody disrespects you, I'm going to fight for you, like, over not.
So how do they feel about that? That you don't get angry with the Hispanics anymore, that your mindset has changed. How do they feel? Do they feel that you've sold out, or that are they happy that you've sort of moved on with yourself?
To be honest with you, I done did so much for my hood, and my parents and my family is like at the top of my hood. Mm-hmm. My hood really couldn't tell me nothing. Like, I done had problems with my homegirls through the past. I done fought my homegirls over because I work at homeboys, or you think you're too good, you trying to switch up, you trying to lead the hood, like you don't want to do what we doing no more, or you got your Mexican homegirls with you. Like, it's always going to be a problem. It's always going to be a problem. But at the end of the day, my hood really can't do too much to me because I done did it all for my hood. So it's like, what more can you tell me to do? Mm-hmm. You feel me? Because I done did it all, been through it all. So you ain't did nothing. So therefore, it ain't nothing for you to say to me. And if you got something to say, we can always fight.
And do you try and bring some of the people out of your hood to here?
I do, but at the same time, it's a choice. It got to be what you want to do. A lot of people ain't always ready for change. Yeah. And change is the hardest thing.
But some, you know, your tattoos now, does some of them represent something in your life? Like all the names you've got?
Majority of all my tattoos is gang tattoos. But when from my hood, I got blue chucks because I'm a Crip. This say flirt with roses and a prayer hand. This
Where's
is my
the blue
brother.
Chucks because you're a Crip?
The blue chucks is right here on my wrist.
Bend your wrist to the right and to the left so the camera.
And then it say flirt. This is my brother. He passed away. He got shot in the head in 2005 or whatnot.
Was it due to
gang violence or whatnot? Y'all got a skull with roses. It say life's a gamble. Some dice, some bullets, a ski mask. Cause I used to rob people. I used to wear a ski mask. So I put taking things, goon. I got a big E and a C on my back arms. That's my hood, East Coast. See no evil, speak no evil, hear no evil. But when it's a code that I live by. This is my little brothers and my little sisters. It's a scroll. And whatnot. My hood name, Pugalok. I put it Pugalok. On my fingers. Yeah, that's what they call me. Pugalok or Little Lady Evil.
Little Lady Evil, what does that mean?
They call me Little Lady Evil because I used to be mean. But when I used to always be mad and I just wanted to fight and everybody always thought I was just poison. But when I.
So what about the ones on your
face? On my face, it say love with a heart. This is my ex-boyfriend name, Ronnie. And then it say hate with a knife. Oh, when I used to hate real hard. Mm. Then my chest, the life I live ain't the life I chose. And the angel and the devil. The angel was all what I used to be, and then the devil was across my heart, because that's how I turned evil when I was gangbanging.
Yeah.
Oh, when I, but.
And what about the last one on your neck?
This on my neck, it's a rose with my grandma name. She always been there for me, so she's my blossom, Bon Bon. And then it say kisses, and this is my ex-boyfriend named Ronnie. So don't ever get a boy's name tattooed. Like, it's the worst thing ever. I'm going to tattoo remover right now to get rid of it. Blue is Crips. Oh, well, not that's what I am. And then the red be Bloods. Mexicans, the SAs, they wear whatever color. They don't wear blue or red or nothing like that. They usually wear black, white, gray. Mm. And stuff like that, when I like Dodger colors and stuff like that.
So with the Mexican, what kind of deal?
Yeah,
that's what you're saying, black and that.
That's the Mexican for essay.
With you, do you still, because you've changed and all of that, but do you still wear your color for your team to show that you're still representing your team?
I mean, not so much, it's not so much of a representation. I don't represent for nobody but myself nowadays, like, but it's just what I know. Like, it's hard to change of what you know. Like, I've always grew up blue, gray, white, black my favorite color, blue my favorite color, and gray, like, them just my main colors. Like, I can tell you won't never catch me in red. I don't care how much I change how my life direct, I still won't ever put on red. Like, it's just a feeling to me. I can't do it.
So you still got that feeling inside.
See that machine back there?
Mm-hmm.
That's a laser treatment. Go ahead, big dog.
How does it look when you remove your tattoos? Does it look really bad?
It's no. I've had tattoos removed off of my forearm.
Wow.
There's nothing there.
Ain't even a scratch. You feel a big old scar.
But this is like in the process. You see how it's broken up right there?
Yeah.
That's in the process. That's been hit a couple times.
How much did you take off?
Huh?
How much did you take off?
Nothing.
Do it for free.
Yeah. And it's our priorities, our face, neck, and forearm.
anything visible. If it's a gang-related tattoo, we're going to boost it to the top of the list. If it's an ex-girlfriend's name, ex-boyfriend's name, you might have to wait a year. Unless you're me, you can have as many ex-girlfriends as you want.
But they're incarcerated. So they're in jail. They're coming in shackles.
So they can't have contact.
We have to block that off so that there's no contact with anybody else. Because they're mandated by the courts to remove their tattoos. They're youngsters.
Oh, okay.
So they're in 13 to 18.
So say something like this. What sort of funding do you get for something like this? Does the government support it 100%?
I mean, we get, I think, 4% from 4% as a government. Most of our funding is foundations.
Mm-hmm.
21% is homeboy businesses. The bakery, the cafe, the merchandise, the silkscreen. You know. But we should give, because we help. This is the biggest gang intervention in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Biggest gang intervention. You know, there's nothing like it anywhere, you know, and we try our best, you know, to keep this place up. And the truth is, you know, there's an idea in the world that some lives mean less than others.
Mm.
And that's the truth. But it's not reality.
Mm.
No life means less than others. We're all equal, right?
Mm.
You know, we stand against that idea of a life meaning less than somebody else's life because we're all equal. You know, we want to imagine, and I quote G when I say this, we want to imagine a circle of compassion. And nobody standing outside of that circle.
Yeah.
There is no us and them.
Yeah.
It's just us.
Yeah.
You know.
The homeboy, you know, was really inspired by what they do. You know, like they do a lot of real stuff, like a lot of stuff that people ain't thought of as well. Things such as like bakeries and getting connected with certain enterprises so they have that connection where they could distribute their things and bring in some sort of money to fund the actual homeboy company.
Mm-hmm.
The guy I was speaking to said they don't rely on government too tough.
Mm-hmm.
About how much you say that? About 4%?
Mm-hmm.
About 4%, you know?
Homeboys. Well, for me, homeboys was really emotional and really great experience. I learned a lot. They told some really, really powerful stories that actually touched me.
Yo, we got shot 3 times. And she had loads of tattoos, 32 tattoos.
How old is she?
22.
The industry is actually that they, like within London, yeah, it's like sometimes when you ask for help, it's like they give you help within their own time, depending where you're going. With homeboy industry, they give you help as when you need it. As soon as you're like, if I went in there and I was a gang member and I went in there for help, they'll take my details, everything, and they'll help me on that day, help me look for a job, everything. That's something I like, really like in homeboy. Like,
stuff that they do, like just taking people off the streets, you know, giving them a guy, like opening the arms up to those who are willing. Like it's not a forcing. Like, you have to be willing. You have to be at that stage ready to change. You know, like they say, you can steer the horse to the river, but you can't force it to drink. That's exactly what he said, and that's true. You know, so it's people that come there that are ready. You know, that at that stage for development, for change. You know.
So when we was interviewing the artist, he was telling his story from mouth. And by hand, so if you couldn't follow by mouth, you can follow by hand. And he was creating the story without starting.
Yeah, there was a girl we met. She basically told us her story on that, and it was a bit touching. And she's basically improved in her life, isn't it? Because she's kind of like not too much on the road thing, but she's getting a job. She went for a job today.
It was all that sports this lady, you know. Gangbanging and all that, telling me her dramas and that, comparing. She's asking me what's it like in London. It's nothing like this, though. It's nothing like this. They don't need to come out here and see what it's really like, you know? Like, it's crazy. crazy. But
to me the most, the girl saying to me that she got shot 3 times. I can't believe a girl got shot 3 times. Because I've never knew no one to get, especially a girl, to get shot 3 times and still be alive. That's a big shock to me. It did sadly hit me today when I saw that girl. Yeah.
What they have there and how they all used to deal with gangs and what facilities they have, like the tattoo removing. And the tattoo removing, when they remove it, doesn't even look like they had a tattoo in their life. Never ever. You wouldn't even think twice.
Because they're bringing people that have convictions, records, even tattoos on their bodies. That as soon as you get a tattoo, you're stereotyped straight away. So if you get a T on your face, you're stereotyped. They don't look at you twice, but they're helping people understand that there's no need to stereotype them. And they're trying to show that they're just as normal as you. So homeboy is actually building a reputation for the drug, well not drug people, but gangs, ex-drug users and all that, to show that under all these tattoos and colourings and drug using, they're just normal people. But just you people don't take the time to find out, so you don't know. They're actually taking their time to find out about these people and their background and why they actually turn like this, which is very interesting.
And this year, as if the people don't want to get help, then they won't be able to help them. They only have to, if they want to get help, then they can go and get help. Yeah. They won't force them into getting help.
Yeah, it's your decision to go there, so it's not like they're pressurizing you. It's your choice to make. If you want to change, they're there to help you change. But if you want to continue living the life you live, they're not going to hold you back.
Like now they say if they could do it over again, they'd definitely stay in school. The girl says she would continue playing basketball. That's what she said. She said she'll continue playing basketball. She would have got somewhere with it. So like a lot of the time, we tend to give up our hobbies, which could have got us somewhere for the wrong road, you know? Like we just go down that wrong path, easily to stray, which leads to a dead end, you know?
Get Gregory or something like that.
Gregory Boyle.
Yeah, Father G. He basically brought, he was a priest, right?
Yeah.
He was a priest, went to church. He was burying people, didn't like it. Just went around on the motorbike, around different hoods, kind of telling them, come to the homeboy. And the homeboy is the biggest...
gang intervention.
Yeah, biggest one in the world, isn't it? Like, I think that's a big achievement.
America is more tough and serious than London. What people in London are doing is just trying to be the Americans, but no way in hell they can go through what the Americans
do. Now that I've seen the way Americans go on, London ain't nothing to me anymore, really.
When I see gangs in London, it's actually, I want them to classify.
I'm just gonna laugh.
They're just normal people, because if they're gangs, they will go through the same troubles and struggles that the people over here go through. They've got, from the age of 13, being beaten up by 5 older guys that are bigger than them, big men, stepped on their head, face, everything,
overbeaten. She gets that in their face.
Yeah, and then getting tattoos from 13. What is back over there, just people trying to do it, but it's not happening. They just need to stop, it's a big joke. In America, they're serious. On Friday, you're going to see how serious they are.
Compared to London, it's like we're not even trying, because the government's like trying to say, yeah, gang members need help,
and we're trying to give that for the gang members, but then the government want to cut the funding down, which is not right.
Like, homeboy got it, man. For everything, like, London should be exactly like that, you know?
And plus, London gangs are nothing compared to American gangs.
But today was a good day, man. It really inspired me, you know, I really learned a lot from people's experiences, from what people are going through, what people have been through, from the leaders, the ones that are showing the young lot, mentoring them, you know. A lot of women doing the catering and the cafeteria and all that. I learned a lot still.
Believe and achieve, basically. You know what I mean? Set your target and find help, bro, because being in the gang's not a way forward, bro. Especially when you're going in and out of jail. When you come out, you ain't got no home, no money, no job, nothing, then you're gonna wanna start begging for jobs and that. Well, you should have thought about that in the first place. Basically, like, homeboy can do that for you.
will change, give you like a second chance. You know?
But overall, my experience today was truly amazing. I can't wait to go back. Hopefully meet some more people, interact with them. And they're just truly nice people like us, normal people. Just because they got tattoos, all different types, all on their face, arms, head, eyes. Don't judge them because they're harmless. They're literally harmless. They're just normal people like us.